Blackstone Audio presents A Specter of Justice, a Sam Blackman mystery by Mark de Castrique. This book is read by William Dufris. For Linda. Better that 10 guilty persons escape than that one innocent suffer. Sir William Blackstone, 1765. Chapter 1. Eating a jelly-filled donut takes concentration. I hadn't been concentrating, and my first bite sent a glob of red jelly squirting down the front of my white shirt. Thank you, Hewitt Donaldson, attorney at law. He was the reason for the donut. He was the reason for the white shirt. Hewitt's office was down the hall from the Blackman and Robertson Detective Agency. My partner, Nakayla Robertson, and I had a three-room suite in the Adler Court Building on Asheville's historic Pack Square. Near both the police station and Buncombe County Courthouse, the location was overrun with attorneys. And where there are attorneys, there's potential business for private investigators. I sat in my office trying to scoop up the glob of jelly with the edge of a manila folder containing the notes for the sworn testimony I would be delivering later that morning. Bad idea. I managed only to smear the red filling across my shirt and the folder. Maybe the jury would think the defendant shot me on my way to the witness stand. Nice look. Definitely you. I swiveled my chair around to face Nakayla standing in the doorway. She shook her head like she was reprimanding a 5-year-old. It's Hewitt's fault. My whiny excuse sounded like it came from a 5-year-old. Nakayla held her arms away from her side and pivoted in a complete circle. Her neatly pressed navy blue dress was unscarred by stains or crumbs.
Hewitt gave me a donut, and I ate it. I didn't try to wear it.
I looked at my watch. It's 8:30. Think I can make it home to change?
Maybe if I drive you and then drop you at the courthouse so you don't have to park. Let me get my purse.
She crossed the middle room that served as the client conversation area and entered her office. I stood, clutching the file in one hand and reaching for my suit coat with the other. The door to the hall opened and a ghastly pale face peered through the crack.
Oh, good. It worked. I brought you a matching tie.
Hewitt Donaldson's office manager stepped inside. Shirley the Strange. At some point, I must have been told Shirley's last name, but I'd forgotten it. She didn't look like she had a last name, unless it was Underworld. Her white makeup was caked on like frosting, and her black eyeliner and lipstick would send little children scurrying under their mother's skirts. She had recently permed her hair into a tangle of inky black coils that bounced as she walked, as if demonic slinkies had sprouted from her head. She was also one of the smartest and funniest people I knew.
What worked?
Nakayla joined Shirley in my doorway. The women stood in stark contrast. Nakayla, a tall, slender African-American whom I dearly loved, projected both warmth and regality. Shirley, white, short, and wispy, projected a life force from some other astral plane.
Hewitt's idea,
Shirley said.
Although it pains me to give him credit, he didn't want Sam going into court looking too slick.
Nakayla laughed.
Too slick? Sam?
I have my days, I said. I was the hit at my senior prom.
Then you must have been homeschooled,
Shirley said.
Here, Mr. GQ, wear this.
She handed me a god-awful powder blue tie with misshapen polka dots.
These dots are stains, I said. Wow, Nakayla, he is Sherlock Holmes. Here's another hint. You'll find a nice assortment of ketchup, mustard, and barbecue sauce gracing that fine polyester fabric. What does that tell you?
Hewitt wore it to lunch only one time.
Impressive. Those detective correspondence courses are paying off.
And his reason? I asked.
Oh, Sam, I thought you were going 3 for 3. I bet your smarter partner knows. To have the jury identify with him,
Nakayla said.
Right. Hewitt doesn't want them thinking Heather hired some big-time PI who framed poor Clyde.
Clyde Atwood was on trial for shooting and wounding a police officer in the course of a domestic violence incident. Hewitt was representing his wife, Heather, in the separate, contested divorce case, and in this rare instance, Hewitt was allied with the criminal prosecutor seeking to put Clyde away for a long stretch.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.